Good afternoon and welcome to the celebration of worship today. God bless you for being today in church here at GBC, driving church once again. And we're going to have a great time together, and I really appreciate you coming today, and may your heart be blessed and encouraged. Every year Memorial Day comes, and it's often marked by cookouts and parades and fireworks and the beginning of warm days of summer. And I think the warm day is already here. However, this Memorial Day will be limited to many Americans still being told to stay in, stay home, and to avoid social gatherings. Actually, Memorial Day is a day to those that pause and reflect on the sacrifice of those who helped to make us free. And at Gethsemane Baptist Church, we proudly today remember the sacrifice and have a profound respect for the men and the women who put their lives on the line, and especially for those who paid the ultimate price for their country and also for the freedom that we today are able to enjoy and participate in. This Memorial Day, when you gather with your family or you rest alone, be sure you reflect and think about the price that was paid and ask yourself this question: what makes Memorial Day different, and what makes the difference from all other days? In answering that question, I want you to remember the hand of God is not only in the fact of founding this great nation that we live in today, but also in guiding the men and the women who paid an extreme price for its preservation, and also to ensure that you and I cherish the freedom that has been given us. Before I close, I want to share the 23rd Psalm with you today, but I also want to say this: God bless America. King David said, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod, thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever." We've been in and continue to go through what could be categorized as hard times, trying times, perilous times. There are a lot of other words today that can describe that. But when we face trials, we've got to remember something today, and we need to remember who God is. When facing trials, don't get so focused on your trials that you forget to focus upon the Lord. For he has promised, listen, he has promised to care for us as a shepherd cares for his sheep in green pastures and by the still waters, restoring our souls, anointing our wounds with his oil, and today filling our cups to overflowing. He is the keeper of our lives, and his goodness and his mercy will continue to follow us all the days of our life. God is with you and I today, and he is not about to leave us. We can count on the Lord. I'll simply say this, as Scripture declares, great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. Praise the Lord, church. Amen. Here comes a song to bless your heart today. The God Who Stays, done by Matthew West. This is an awesome song. May it mightily bless your heart today. Again, welcome. We're glad that you're here. I pray you're going to be blessed really good today.
If I were you, I would have given up on me by now. I would have labeled me a lost cause, 'cause I feel just like a lost cause. If I were you, I would have turned around and walked away. I would have labeled me beyond repair, 'cause I feel like I'm beyond repair. Oh, but somehow you don't see me like I do. Somehow you're still here. You're the God who stays. You're the God who stays. You're the one who runs in my direction. When the
awesome song done by Matthew West today. Folks, we're going to the Lord in prayer. And we're believing Him today to do what only He can do, because He's a mighty God. I'm also today, behind me, you'll see the cross and you'll see the flag. Two representations of freedom. Thank God for the red, the white, and the blue, which reminds us of our nation, our country, that we are not ashamed to be an American. And listen, many of you in this parking lot have defended that freedom in the military. God bless you and thank you for that. And also, there were many who did not come home, and our hearts go out to their families because they made the extreme sacrifice, because they stood up for that flag. But that cross represents another freedom. It represents the freedom that comes through salvation. Thank God, the freedom that we have as a nation, but it's actually a temporary freedom, because we're not going to be in this nation and this land forever. But the cross represents the freedom that came to us by what Jesus accomplished in dying on the cross for you and I. And thank God that we have that freedom today. For whom the Son sets free is free indeed. I pray you're free today. And if not, I pray you will be before this day is over. Father, we come before your presence. Thank you today for a nation called the United States of America. Thank you for men and women who've served in the military of this country. Whatever branch, it doesn't matter. Those who have stood up for freedom. And God, we pray today for the families of those, even though it was years ago or maybe it was recent, that lost their life in combat. We pray in Jesus' name that you'll comfort their families and embrace them. And we pray that each one knew you as their personal Savior. And Lord, today they are marching to a different cadence. They're marching to a cadence that's rejoicing in the presence of God. And Father, we also stand with this cross today, because real freedom comes through the cross, the sacrifice that was made, the price that was paid, and what Jesus, by shedding His blood, giving His life, we could have life and have it more abundantly. Thank you for that price that was paid. Now, the blessing of this cross today and the blessing of the blood is extending today hope to every person. The person that's lost, they can come to Christ and seek Him and cry out for forgiveness, and He will forgive and receive them and make them His child. For those who have drifted away, God, right now, my heart is really heavy. In a nation that is one nation under God, we're supposed to be an example as Christians. We're supposed to be standing up for the truth. Lord, it seems like Christians are more concerned about material things right now with this pandemic than they are about their eternal soul and winning souls to Christ and glorifying God and trusting Him. This is just a prelude of what is to come. This is just a scratch in the paint compared to that day when tribulation will be poured out on this earth. Help us to awaken to the need and to live the life and to be the Christians that you have called us to be. Help us to walk, Lord, the true walk. Help us to look to the true God and help us to live by true faith. Now, Father, I pray you'll continue to bless this meeting, this worship, and God, may you be glorified in it. Hearts and Glory are coming to sing, and I pray you'll bless them as they today sing their hearts out to the glory of God and to bless others. Bless our audience today that are watching by Facebook. We appreciate each one of them today. We want to shout out, Lord, and let folks know we're praying for them. We've got friends in North Carolina. Lord, we appreciate Mike and Jackie watching there. We appreciate Rick and Jackie in Fort Myer, Florida, that's watching, and others all around, God, in state and out of state, and even in our local community. We pray your blessings upon them. Now guide and direct us today and be honored in all that is accomplished. To God be the glory, in Jesus' name. And all God's children said, amen. Hearts and Gloria Anderson.
One glorious day, Jesus came and made me whole. with God's great redemption plan. I'm satisfied, it's sufficient for all men. I'm satisfied with his work on Calvary. But my Lord is fully satisfied with me. I want my Lord to be satisfied with me. I want my life to be what it have it be. Then when I come to that great eternity, his smile will say he is satisfied with me. Lord, give me strength, give me courage, make me bold, and I might lead some lost sheep into thy fold. Then I might stand unafraid unto for thee, that you might be fully satisfied with me.
Seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He hath loosed the fateful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Hallelujah, his truth is marching on. I have seen him in the watchfires of 100 circling camps. They have builded him an altar in the evening dews and damps. I can read his righteous sentence by the dim and flaring lamps. His day is marching on. Glory. Transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us live to make men free. While God is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory.
One more song today. This is an interesting song done by Andrew Peterson, and it's called Romans 11 Doxology. Romans 11 Doxology. As a matter of fact, we're back in Romans 11. I've got a message today and one more, the crescendo next Sunday in Romans 11, and we're looking forward to that. But we've got a great message that God's given us today from Romans 11 that I pray will bless your heart. But just before that, here's a song, Romans 11 Doxology.
The riches and the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable his judgments, how untraceable his paths. Who knows the mind of the riches and the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable his judgments, how untraceable his paths. Who knows the mind of our God? Who could bring counsel to him? Who is given to God? God should repay. For from him, through him, to him is everything. To God be the glory for.
Great song with a great message. I want to remind you that we said earlier today, before the service started, next Sunday we're going to provide you with an opportunity of prayer that if you want to get here a little bit earlier, and I'm going to take time to just go around through the parking lot and pray at your car. And if you'd like me to pray with you, I'd be more than honored. It's not forced on you. It's simply if you need prayer. You can also contact me anytime. Call me, anything, any way you need to get in touch with me, prayer needs, whatever, right here for you, and anything that I can do to help you. But and even after the service, I went by and prayed with some of you this afternoon, and I'll be available after the service. If you can hang around a few moments and you need prayer, just stay where you are. Don't leave with everybody else. Just stay where you are. And I'll be more than glad to come and pray with you and help you in any way that I can. I appreciate each of you today. Thank you. Thank you for this body of believers, this church, the people that still believes in the Word of God and worship. Regardless of where you are, you can worship the Lord. Today we're talking about to know God is to love God. And we're continuing in Romans 11. It seems like we've been on that for a long time. But we're trying to extract every verse from every verse, everything that God has for us that will encourage and bless our hearts. And so we're going to be in verses 25 through 36 today, actually 32, I believe. And we'll finish up from 33 up to 36 next Sunday. But Romans 11, of course, 9, 10, and 11, are very interesting verses that are contained in chapter 11. That and, of course, the chapters are very interesting, 9, 10, 11. But realize that's great truth for us in the Word of God. In a world today of superficial relationships and facts masquerading today basically as knowledge, it's easy to treat God as a commodity. I'm going to tell you, God is not a commodity. We gather certain bits of info today about God, and we call it knowing God. I would really encourage you today to make sure that you know who God is. And just not today as a commodity, and just not as a supply of your need, and just not in a superficial relationship, but you know Him personally and intimately today. We can only worship someone that we love today, and we can only love someone that we truly know. That's why today we entitled the message, To Know God is to Love God. So many people today only seek a certain kind of God in their life. They seek a God in their minds, and that's who they think God is. We perceive, or we read something, or we conjure up something, or we heard somebody say something that we thought sounded good, but if we're not careful, if it doesn't agree with Scripture, it can be totally wrong. God wants you today to see Him as Lord. And if you today will understand the fact of Jesus Christ and receiving Him as your personal Savior and being Lord of your life, you can understand then God as Lord. He's just not sitting in heaven doling out things to you when you want stuff. He's just not there to wipe away your tears. Yes, He does all that, but He's God. And we've got to realize today that we owe Him our allegiance, our respect, our dedication. We owe Him our life. He wants you to see Him as Jesus, who is God in the flesh, God incarnate. A.W. Tozer, who is the dean of writers, said this, quote, "What comes in our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us. We tend by a secret law of the soul to move toward our mental image of God." Now, I hope you understood what Tozer was writing there. In other words, let me just paraphrase that for you, if I may. Our personalities will inevitably today conform to our gods. You know, whatever is the God of your life, what is the God of your life today? What's controlling your life? Is God just a pastime? It's someone you call on when you need something, or you're going through a mess in life and you think, well, I can always call on God. Folks, listen, God's a whole lot more than that, isn't He? God is God Almighty, the everlasting Father. We've got to understand who He is. If your God is the mighty creator today of Scripture, you've got a lifetime of joy ahead of you. So many people right now living in defeat and worry and fret and anxiety. That's not God's intention for your life. It's God's intention for your life to live as more than a conqueror, triumphant. Because that God's not defeated. Yeah, but preacher, what are we going to do in these times that we're going through and all these problems? And they're saying that we may have another time of this coronavirus coming back and hitting us again in September. We will trust the same God, whether it's September or any of the other 11 months. We will trust the same God because our God is a faithful God. Now, according to the Bible, our God is the everlasting Father, the God of hosts, the Lord of heaven and earth, the author and the finisher of our faith. He is the comforter, He is the counselor, and He is the creator. So when you start looking who God is, He's everything. He's the great physician, and He is the God of all grace. His name is I Am. He is the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, the end, the first, and the last. He's the Holy One of Israel. We can call Him Jehovah, the Most High, and the Lord of the living and the Lord of the dead. He's God. He is the maker, the mediator today. He's the man of sorrows who walked sorrow's street. He bore our sins, carried our sorrows, died on the cross, arose victorious. Thank God, ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. And we have a promise He's coming back again one day. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen. Not only is He all of that, but today He is our prophet, our priest, our king, our redeemer, our rock, our refuge, our ruler of heaven today and earth. And He's a friend of the sinner today, because I'm glad all that will come to Him, He will in no wise cast out. Listen, God seeks to be known. Some people think, well, He's kind of like the Wizard of Oz in that movie, you know. They go and there's a guy behind the curtain shifting things and turning knobs and flashing lights and all. That's not God. He's not hiding behind a curtain. He is sitting on the throne. But more importantly, He needs to be sitting on the throne of your heart and your life. You can know God. He wants you to know Him today. And He wants to reveal Himself today. And He does it in His Word. If you're not reading the Word of God, you're totally missing God. Please join with me today, and you don't have to stand, for the reading of God's Word as we open our Bibles to Romans chapter 11, 25, and let's read down and see what the Word has for us today. "For I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery, lest ye should be wise in your own concepts, that blindness in the part is happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in. And so all Israel shall be saved. That's an interesting point there. As it is written, there shall come out of Zion the deliverer. Boy, that is awesome. He is the deliverer today. And shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob. For this is my covenant or my promise unto them when I shall take away their sins. As concerning the gospel, they are enemies for your sakes. But as touching the election, they are beloved for the Father's sake. For the gifts and the calling of God are without repentance. For as ye in times past have not believed God, ye have now obtained mercy through their unbelief. Even so have these also now believed, that through your mercy they might obtain mercy. That last part of that, I want you to catch that. That through your mercy they may also obtain mercy. For God hath concluded them all in unbelief, that he might have mercy. Listen to this phrase. That he might have mercy upon them all. We all stand, listen, we all stand in need of the mercy of God, don't we? We do. Every human being on this earth stands in need of the mercy of God. As believers, we need to relish this mercy, and we need to trust God in all things today. You know what we're doing, friends? Listen, I'm being very candid, very honest with you. We want to trust God with some things. We want to release to God some areas. Folks, he cannot be a part-time God in your life. He's got to be Lord of all, or not Lord at all. And therefore today, you just can't turn parts of your life over to him. You need to turn all of your life over to him. We're here indeed today in need of strength in our souls. We all need that. None of us have attained or achieved or come to the pinnacle of the place today that we could be, should be, and ought to be for the Lord. We still fall short, don't we? And if you think that you've reached that place, I hate to tell you, you haven't. The fact is today, I want to say our worship is not a ritual. We're not here to have a ritual or go through some means of worship or do something that we think is right when God's word has rediscovered and has declared what is right in our worship. For there's meaning in our worship. There's real meaning in our worship. Some even think we cannot worship unless we're in the building behind me. I hate to tell you, the question that I have for you today, are you coming for a social gathering or are you coming to worship God? You know, we've fellowshipped in this parking lot. As a matter of fact, with the conditions being right now, you can probably fellowship better in the parking lot than you can in that building. I was listening to some videos of some of the local churches of what they're having to face. The doors are open, you can't open the doors. You come in, you got to sit down 6 feet in front of you, 6 feet on either side, 6 feet behind you. Oh, pretty sure we'll just do it any old way. Don't worry about it. No, we're not going to do it just any old way. We're going to do it the right way because God honors what is right. And folks, listen today. I want to be back in there behind that pulpit just as much as you want to be in those pews. And we'll get to that day, and hopefully it won't be that much longer. But we've got to realize what we're here to do. And actually today, you can commune with God in this parking lot. You can call upon him anywhere, any place, any time. Worship is not determined by the place. Worship is determined today by the presence of God in your life. And you've got to understand that if he's in your life, you can worship the Lord. You can praise him at any point and any time. I'm thankful that we've been able to provide a setting of worship where many churches have not been able to do so, unfortunately. You know, I want you to know today, God has blessed this worship in, 8, 9 weeks? We've been doing this and realizing that God has worked miracles here. You may not know about them, but I'm telling you, he has worked miracles in lives. God has done things and he has saved people. I've gotten texts, I've gotten information from people that they've gotten saved not only in this parking lot, but watching through Facebook, on television. Hallelujah! It's not important that you know everything. It's important that God is glorified in everything. God has changed people here. I've gotten texts just this past week about how lives have been changed and the walk is closer and as God's been moving in their families and their lives. Folks, I'm telling you, I wish you could put my shoes on for 1 week and see and hear what I hear and see. And I'm telling you today, you would be rejoicing in the Lord. Amen. God has enriched our relationships in our neighborhood here. Thank God for the great folks that we have in this neighborhood, not only on Blue Ridge, but all around us, that they are hearing the word and they're experiencing you and I in the presence of God. God has reached beyond the parking lot by Facebook and television. He has lifted up, he's encouraged people, not only in the Commonwealth of Virginia, but people that live in other locations and other states. God has blessed families here and drawn families even closer. God has done beyond what you see happening here, just you driving up, parking the car, and listening to the songs and the message. God has done even more than that. And I pray he's moved on your heart today, all in worship here at a drive-in church location. Sure, it's been inconvenient, and you can ask these folks that's been working every week faithfully and doing what they're doing. It's been uncomfortable, but you know what? We don't care about that. What we care about is that God is honored and you are blessed, amen. And that's what we believe it's all about, and that we are in an atmosphere right now of worship, hallelujah. Now, to know God is to love God. Did you know the Bible is God speaking to us? You know, the Bible is God literally speaking to us. He is the author of the word. We're in a church that believes that there's one authority. There's one authority that resides over us. And what that authority is the word of God. It's the Bible. So we know that God is speaking to us from his word, from the Bible. Whether in the church, in a platform, it matters not, or in a parking lot, in the back of this pickup truck, there's a pulpit. Whether in the church, there's a pulpit in the middle of the platform. There's a platform here, and there's a pulpit. And guess what? That pulpit tells us that there's something important that goes on right here in this location of this church. That pulpit is there to hold up the book, the Bible today, which is God speaking to us. If we are preaching something other than the word, we're preaching the wrong thing. So the Bible is God showing us himself. He's revealing himself. Oh, let us be attentive to listen and to receive what God is saying. For me to help you today really is to show you today the God of the Bible. Not to give you an opinion, but to give you the facts of what God says. To show you there's a God who forgives you of your sin. To show you today there's a God who is good. To show you today there's a God who is merciful. To show you today there's a God who is holy. And to show you today simply this, and it all boils down to the fact, to show you Jesus, amen. Hallelujah. The more you know about God, the more you know today of God is to know it is God who carries you, who sustains you, and who walks with you through life. It's God who solves your problems. It's God who heals your body. I've walked through this parking lot here a little bit ago and just praying with people in their cars, standing outside the vehicle and praying for their needs and their burdens and their sicknesses and their trials. And we prayed and we believe God is going to do something mighty. Amen. To know God is the greatest comfort that we can have today, and the greatest hope that we today can latch our lives onto and know that it is real. So we come to the theme today, and I've only got about 2 or 3 points to share with you, but the theme is this. The more you know God, oh, this is good. You ought to ring that horn off its hook. The more today you know God, the more you worship God. The more you know God, the more you will worship God. Amen. You know why some of us, our life doesn't have any luster to it, doesn't have any praise to it. We just live from trouble and trial, problem to pain. It's because we haven't really learned to worship God. Number one, we should be humbled by the truth of God's word. Paul talked about the Jews had rejected the gospel. And the gospel then turned to the Gentiles. And we've already seen that in chapter 11. The Gentiles being saved then prompted the Jews to salvation. Now, we also have seen how that Paul warned the Gentiles about something today that we have warned about also, and it's called P-R-I-D-E. The problem with pride is the middle letter, just like the problem with sin is the middle letter, and it's I. We sin, I sin, you sin. If we're not careful, we can get embraced into pride and it'll start controlling us. Paul references Proverbs 3:7, where Solomon said, "Be not wise in thine own eyes, fear the Lord, and depart from evil." That's exactly what we need to do. Why does the Bible tell us that God opposes the proud? Paul knew the conditions of our heart. Jeremiah and many other writers of the Bible knew the condition of our heart because, yes, our heart is desperately wicked. And folks, you know, we may think we are holy and right and admirable and doing all this. And you've got to look at yourself in reality today. You'd be lost and going to hell if it wasn't for Jesus Christ. He's the one that died. He's the one that took your sins. He's the one that took everything that was against you and nailed it to his cross. He knew, Paul knew the condition of our heart. Paul knows a little knowledge, if you're not careful, it can puff you up. And here's an example. A person's married for 1 year, right? We don't need them writing a marriage manual of how to have a successful marriage. You just began. You don't have any idea. So realizing receiving knowledge and applying knowledge is different. Let me say that again. Receiving knowledge. Say it with me right there in your car. Receiving knowledge. I can't hear you. Receiving knowledge and applying knowledge is different. So what do you mean? Paul's given a warning. The more we know about God, the more humble we should be before God. As a Christian, the more humble you are, then the less offended you are. So therefore, actually, we've been, if you think about it, we're the ones that's been offensive. We've been offensive to God more than people that have been, "Oh, you don't know what somebody said about me." Get over it. That's what I'm going to say to you. Get over it. Your life and my life has been a whole lot more offensive to God than what somebody said to you about you or whatever. Forget it. Don't worry about it. Grace teaches us to be humble. And therefore, it's God who picks us up, loves us, saves us, and it's God who sustains us today. Even when we didn't recognize him, he saw us. You know what that is? It's grace. It's God reaching to us and giving us something that we don't deserve. Grace is something that changes us. It's something today that will change your life. It's something today that will absolutely turn your life upside down. A mark of humbleness is the presence of gratitude. Gratitude is thanksgiving. Thank the Lord for every blessing. Thank the Lord for his grace. Thank you, Jesus, for dying on the cross. Thank you, Lord, for supplying my need. Thank you, God, for being a friend that sticks closer than a brother. Thank you that you're the lily of the valley and the bright and morning star. Thank you that you love me with an everlasting love. Thank you that you prepared a place for me. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for everything. Thank you for our church. Thank you for this gathering. Thank you for the blue skies. Thank you for the gentle breeze. Thank you for the birds that are singing. Thank you for the flowers that are blooming. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, for every blessing you send our way. Amen. Oh, what a mighty God we serve. See, the less you think about grace, the more you think about yourself. And I'm going to tell you what happens when you're thinking about, well, how about me? Well, what about you? You know what? You might as well carry a sign around and have an arrow pointing down, prideful. Because that's exactly what it is. The grace of God should humble us. Secondly, today, and we're nearing the end of the message and the end of this time together. So listen carefully as we zero in today on what God's got for us. We should always be amazed by the providence of God. The sovereignty of God is you looking into the future and trusting God that he will help you to have faith and trust in him. Mark 11:22 says, have faith in God. And that faith in God says, you can say unto this mountain, be thou removed, be thou cast into the sea, and it shall be done. You can trust God. You can trust God in everything. But preacher, what are we going to do about this coronavirus? We're going to trust God. Simply stated. But is it going to get worse? No. It's no need in pondering your mind with questions that you don't have answers to. Just trust God. So providence is something that we can look back Providence is something we can look back and see how God worked through all things. So in verse 25, Paul says, there is a blindness in part, or to put it more correctly, there's a partial hardening of the heart. The gospel turned from the Jews to offer the gospel to the Gentiles as also an awakening to the Jews. But now in verse 26, Paul says, so all of Israel shall be saved. That doesn't mean every Jewish person is going to be saved. I wish every person, you know, the gospel is available to every person. In the book of Titus, it says it's appeared unto every person. Jesus said, all that will come to me, I'll in no wise cast out. All that will come to me. You got to come to him first. Paul is saying in the providence of God, one day we're going to see a large number of people being saved by the nation of Israel. And if you look ahead in prophecy, you'll see that is exactly what God is talking about. But how will the nation of Israel be saved? In verse 26, Paul says, they shall come out of Zion, they shall come out of Zion, the deliverer. Every person is saved the same way. Jew, Gentile, it makes no difference. Red, yellow, black, or white, it makes no difference. You've got to come by the way of the cross. There is no other way. Jesus shed his blood for all mankind. And Jesus said, all that will come to me, yes, he won't cast them out. But he said this in John 14, 6. I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. If you're going to come to God, you've got to come through Jesus, friend. And you must be born again. My question to you today, listen. We've got folks watching on Facebook. We've got people watching on television. We've got you watching in this congregation, in this parking lot. We've got neighbors all around us in this neighborhood, all the way up to Oakley and behind me and beside us and around us. My question to you today is, are you saved? Do you know Christ? Well, preacher, I'm doing the best I can. Doesn't work. Well, I hope my good will outweigh my bad. Not going to work. Well, I hope I can slip in. It's not going to work. Well, I'll do it on my deathbed. I mean, when I'm dying, I'm going to say, hey, forgive me, Jesus. You may not have that opportunity. I've taken away every tool that you've tried to throw today to justify your salvation on you. Because your salvation is not justified on you. It's justified on Jesus. And you've got to come to him today. What I do, realize you're a sinner. The Bible says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The Bible says that we have missed the mark. But the Bible also says that Jesus died on the cross for our sins. He paid the price in full. God commended his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Not only that, but also today he says, if we will call upon him, we can be saved. What do you mean call upon him? Ask God to forgive you of your sins. Why don't you do it right now? Right there in that place where you're at, on that sofa, or in that car, or in that truck, wherever you are, in your home, on your porch, wherever, in your kitchen, wherever you're watching or listening or hearing this, if you've never invited Christ into your life, why don't you say, God, forgive me my sin of rejecting you. Come into my heart, come into my life, and save me. And on the authority of God's word, he will do that. I hope you made that decision today. I pray that you know Christ as your Savior. If you have, please send me a text or something. Let me know how I can help you and bless you. Or just see me after the service. So why? You think about what did Jesus do at the cross? He died there, paying the sins for every person. Every person. All this is, God works powerfully in the gospel. He works offering salvation to all people. We should be amazed at the providence of God. And if you're not a believer, God has providentially brought you here, or you're watching this on Facebook, or hearing this and watching it on television, or wherever you are, and hearing the message today, he's brought you to this point in your life so that you can see your need of Christ. You cannot put it off. Folks, we're not promised tomorrow. And the third point is simply this. We must be changed by the mercy of God. You don't understand the mercy of God if it has not changed your life. You don't understand the mercy of God if it has not changed your life. So if you have received the mercy of God, you should have been changed. Mercy changes a person. Grace is you today getting the good gift of salvation of God that you didn't deserve. It's you today getting the grace of God, the mercy of God that we didn't deserve. Mercy is you deserving the penalty of your sins. But yet, Christ took the penalty and he gave us forgiveness. So it's amazing how God can work through sinful means and bring glory to himself by giving us his mercy. Oh, Barry White sings a song, "Mercy Rewrote My Life." And I want to tell you, that is so true. Has it rewritten your life today? I pray that it has. The ultimate purpose that God has in all of your sin, all of your bad decisions, all your rebellion, is to show you today the mercy that he is extending. At Calvary, every single sin is overrun by the mercy of God. Thank God he has defeated sin, the shackles of sin, the death of sin, the bondage of sin. And he today has set us free through the cross and his redeeming blood. Amen. Blow your horns for Jesus one time. See, we were in a hole. We were in a hole that we were in too deep to get out of. And the only hope that we had was God's rescuing mercy. When the walls are too tall and when your sins are too deep, that's not the end of the story. God extends the clean ropes of his righteousness, for God's mercy is our only hope. And I'm glad today he's offering hope today. You know, God could have said when Adam and Eve sinned, that's it. It's over. Mankind is history. But God is long-suffering to us, but not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Listen, do you want out of the dungeon that you're in today? Are you tired of fighting? Are you tired of struggling? Are you tired of waking up anxious every morning? Are you tired of trying to go to sleep tonight and you're filled with worry and fret? Are you tired of struggle? You don't have to any longer. You can give it all to Christ, and he'll take your life and turn your life around. I pray today that you're saved. And if you're not, I pray that you will today. Perhaps you've already called upon the Lord. I sure pray you have. Maybe there are burdens on your heart today. Just out of curiosity, bow your heads right there in your car. You say, "Preacher, I got struggles, I got trials, I got problems, I got needs, I got things in my life. I need prayer. Pray for me." Just stick your arm out the window and wave your hand. Thank you. Parking lot's covered with arms. Come on, how about you? Everything perfect in your life? Everything good? Stick your arm out that window. "Pray for me, Pastor. I need prayer. I need prayer. I need help. I need hope. I need encouragement. I need strength." I'm glad to tell you, God's offering it to you right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, reach the hearts of those right there in those automobiles, in those homes, those places that people are watching and listening. And I pray that you'll encourage their heart today. I pray that you'll lift them up. I pray they'll cast their care upon you, knowing you care for us. Move on this waiting congregation. We rebuke every evil force that would come against us. Satan, you're defeated. Jesus is Lord. And I pray that that Lord will touch the hearts of people here right now. In this invitation, cry out to God. Make that steering wheel or that place in your car a place that you cry out to God. And do as the psalm says, "I surrender all." Total surrender.
To Jesus,
give it all to him today, now, right now. Let him take over.
All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him in his presence daily live. I surrender.
to do. Surrender all. Give it all to Him today. Cry out to Him. He'll hear your call. He cares for you. When you think nobody else cares, He does. He cares for you. Willing today to surrender it. I'm going to hang on a little longer. No, you don't need to. Just let it go. Let God take it today. If you've been blessed today, just let us know. Sound your horn or wave your hand at your window or something. Let us know you've been blessed of the Lord today mightily. What a mighty God we serve. Thank you. And thank you for coming today. And may God's grace go with you. We're going to close in prayer. If you need prayer, if you want to hang around a few moments, I'll be glad to come to your car and stand outside your car and pray with you. Our desire, my desire, is to minister to you and bless you and to help you in any way that I can. So if you need prayer, don't leave. Just stay where you are a few moments, and once everybody's cleared out, I'll come to you. Father, now go with us, and may your name be glorified in all that is done here today. Thank you, Lord, that you've kept away the rain, the storms, and every Sunday you've done this and opened up the sky and blessed us. I think that is a testimony to your blessing, to your favor, to your goodness. Thank you for what you've done and what you're doing. Now give us safety in our travels. Guide and direct your people and watch over them this week and send some special blessing to each one. And thank you for the honor that we've had to be in your presence today. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Drive safe. Be careful.